Hello and welcome to the WIHS Journal Public Affairs from 104.9 FM. I'm Paul Kretschmer. On today's broadcast, we'll hear about the Italian-American One Voice Coalition from Andre Dimino.
Well, I've been a member of the One Voice Italian-American One Voice Coalition now for about 12 years. It was actually started by Dr. Manny Alfano over 27 years ago, and he's been the leader of our organization, and I've been very pleased to be involved with it.
What was the initial reason for starting another organization? That
our organization is actually an educational organization specifically for defending and correcting the discrimination and stereotyping that occurs to Italian Americans.
And that's been something that the ethnic identity of Italians has faced for a long, long time, isn't it?
Yes, it has, absolutely. Of course, you know, in the early years, it was, blatant discrimination with the jobs and the way they were treated socially and so forth. But now, with respect to what we're talking about, is the fact that there's so much of the stereotyping that occurs in the common media, TV, and the news and everything else.
What does it take to break past the stereotypical assumptions that people might have about someone who has Italy in their ethnicity?
Well, you know, the most typical stereotype that's out there, of course, is that all Italians are involved with the mafia or the mob. And the second one that we've seen more recently with shows like Jersey Shore and so forth are that, you know, Italians are bimbos and buffoons. And, that couldn't be further from the truth. Of course, we can't hide from the fact that there were Italian Americans that were involved in organized crime, but was an infinitesimal percentage. Not the way that it's portrayed in media, where all you see, every time you see an Italian name or someone that's playing an Italian person, they're either mafia or mafioso or bimbos or buffoons, and it couldn't be further from the truth.
Yeah. As far as the work your organization does along those lines, then what sorts of tools or initiatives does your outfit take to do the work that you're involved in?
Well, the most important thing we do is that we educate people, and, you know, we bring to light the fact that the stereotypes are just not accurate, that that there should be fairness and balance, just like with other ethnicities, Paul. You know, when you see, for example, some other ethnicity on TV and there's a negative portrayal of them, there will then be a positive one. Unfortunately, there is no positive portrayals of Italian Americans that you can find in popular media.
Does it take a long time to get past that initial skepticism or just plain ignorance?
Well, it is very tough. Unfortunately, it's a very, very, very pervasive stereotype, and it is tough to get through it. But we have members across the country, and we use, emailing, phone calling, and we try to bring to light the fact that it's just not fair the way Italian Americans are treated.
Yeah. Is the distribution of members in the Italian-American One Voice Coalition pretty uniform across the country, or are there particular pockets of population in places here and there that tend to have a higher percentage of members in your organization?
Well, certainly, the demographics kind of spread with the Italian-Americans themselves. Mm. You know, in places like New Jersey and New York, we have a higher membership because there is a higher population.
Yeah.
It just normally spreads out in that way. But we do have, thousands of what we call defenders across the country. These are people that work with us in the Italian-American One Voice Coalition to push against and push back against these stereotypes.
Does that mean that, for instance, members who encounter something that because of its prejudicial nature that they hear about or see for themselves in the area where they live, do they come to the coalition then to obtain the kind of resources necessary to push back in a positive way then?
Oh, absolutely. That's a very important point, is that we become a resource for these individuals and actually for other groups, not just strictly our members, but other people that know of our organization. They'll report back to us. And I'll give you a great example.
Okay.
And it was actually a Catholic school up in Washington State that was going to have a showing, a family film night with this children's program that was called The Dog Father. And what it was this portrayal of a dog that was a mafia dog, and then it ran away, and then the mobsters were trying to kill the children that the dog was. It was a very negative thing. It was all about Italians. And we spoke with the local archdiocese up there, and we explained how, this was not good. And this was after a local parent contacted us. Mm-hmm. And when we spoke to them, they pulled that movie, and they said in the future they'll be sure that when they, you know, choose a movie, that they wouldn't have one that stereotypes one group over another.
In your experience, do people knowingly offend your perspective, or are they somewhat ignorant of what they're actually saying because they've grown up in an atmosphere where it was so pervasive that they never gave a thought to it?
Wow, you really stated it so well, Paul. That's exactly right. I don't think people do it absolutely intentionally. I mean, that might be a very small percentage, but the great general majority is just because that's the way it's been, and it's just something that they continue to carry on with. And it's unfortunate because it is. It's kind of ingrained in there, and, you know, perception becomes reality. And when these things are constantly portrayed in movies and TV shows and so forth, you know, naturally it just continues. And you're right, it's just part of the atmosphere.
When it comes to the media, motion pictures, television, and so on, does the coalition make itself available to provide expert advice or counsel when outfits are looking to produce something that you would like, that they are willing to listen to your perspective and use your expertise to portray people as positively and as intelligently as possible?
Well, we certainly offered that, but unfortunately, we haven't been taken up on that too much. You know, I think that when, you know, these productions are made and so forth, you know, they've got their own agenda, that they know that this is sold in the past. You know, a mobster movie or a movie with a dumb person in it, you know, it's sold in the past, and they're just going to continue to make it. But we certainly would be available to bring that perspective.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned earlier that there's a distribution of Italian-Americans who all across the United States, so it would seem evident that in the major production areas such as Chicago and Los Angeles, that that industry certainly can't claim it doesn't have access to the expertise, certainly.
No, you're absolutely correct. You know, it's just a question of whether or not they want to make use of it or they just want to continue and perpetuate the stereotype.
As far as your own devotion to this cause, how much of your own time do you devote to this?
Well, if you'd listen to my wife and my business people, they might say too much, but I am committed to it. I mean, I run a medical device manufacturing company.
Oh.
I've got 34 great employees, plus, you know, my wife and I enjoy our time. But you know, this, I don't have other hobbies and so forth, and I'm really committed. You know, you got to consider that my parents are they're from Italy, and I'm first generation, and I know what it took for my grandparents to come over here. And I feel that I have a certain responsibility to their legacy and to virtually all Italian-Americans that fought so hard to become part of this country. You know, my father always told me, you know, this is the greatest country in the world. So, you know, I'm a proud, patriotic American first, but I want to defend my Italian heritage as well.
Yeah, well, I've lost track of how many notices in the newspapers that pointed out that someone who had passed away came over from Europe a long time ago and established themselves in this country, and the accomplishments they had, I cannot help but recognize that the richness and diversity of this community in Middletown, Connecticut has been enhanced beyond all way to really measure it, because people have contributed so much to the place where they chose to come.
No, exactly. You know, and when I make my presentations, I always say that America is like this beautiful quilt, and we're made up of all different pieces, but all together we form one great country, and we got to be so grateful for all the legal immigrants that came here to make this their home and to make America great.
For a listener who would like to follow up on our conversation, Andre, where do you direct them to the next step to find out further information?
Well, the greatest place, just go to our website, or it's really the letters, the initials of our organization, which is IAOVC.org, which stands for Italian American One Voice Coalition.org, IAOVC.org.
Thank you very much, Andre Domino, for speaking with me on today's broadcast. A real pleasure to touch base with you.
I'm so happy to be on your show, Paul. Thank you very much.
For further information about the Italian American One Voice Coalition, call us at 860-346-1049, 860-346-1049. The opinions expressed are those of the participants, not necessarily those of the staff or management of the station. I'm Paul Kretschmer on the WIHS Journal, Public Affairs from WIHS, Middletown.